Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. This is the 15th Sunday after Pentecost. We're glad to be able to gather together in the house of the Lord and receive His good gifts. If you are visiting with us today for the first time, we ask you to sign the guest registry as it's located in the back as you leave this morning. Just a few announcements before we begin worship. Here at St. Paul's, we're looking always looking for different ways in which we can be of service to our community, people in our community. One of the ways that we've decided in these next few months to do this is by hosting a blood drive sponsored by the Red Cross. That will be here held at St. Paul's on Sunday, November 6th. I know that's a ways away, but the Red Cross is only able to come to facilities to provide that if we can have a certain number of people. And so we're in the process of trying to line up people that would be willing to donate blood at that blood drive. Next week, Rosemary Watson, who's kind of heading that, and she's in the back, you can wave at her if you'd like. Hi, Rosemary. She'll be here next Sunday as well, right outside the nursery with a sign-up sheet. Once again, this is a way for us to try to help our community. Blood drive November 6th. Signups will begin next Sunday. Our high school youth, senior high youth group, continue to have a youth booth that will be down at the fall festival here in a few weeks. And they're always looking for help to man the booth during the day. The kids have petitioned for me to write a note so they can get out of school for that week. I do not think that will happen. So we need adults to work in the booth during the day. The sign-up sheet for the Fall Festival booth is located in the Welcome Center area. You also notice in your bulletin an insert regarding the music program. We have a great music program here at St. Paul's. One of the things we're trying to start back up again is a children's choir. Tim is trying to put together that choir again. And so if you have a child that you'd like to sing in that choir, whether they want to or not, just let Tim know that. And we'll try to get this children's choir, which is always a great treat for us. We'll try to get that children's choir off the ground. And later this afternoon, we'll have our tour of the Lutheran Cemetery. This was scheduled for last week, but due to the weather, we've moved that tour to this afternoon at 1 o'clock at the Lutheran Cemetery. We'll have a brief dedication of a plaque commemorating Mayor Bossy. And then there'll be a tour that'll walk through the different sections of the cemetery. So once again, that'll be this afternoon at 1 o'clock. Those are the only announcements I have this morning. We once again pray the Lord grants us His great blessings as He promises to do as we hear His word and receive His forgiveness. We begin our service with the ringing of the bells.
fill my soul.
Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Your testimonies are righteous forever.
Give me understanding that I may live.
Righteous are you, O Lord.
And right.
You have appointed your testimonies in righteousness.
And in all faithfulness.
My zeal consumes me.
Because my foes forget your words.
Your promise is well tried.
And your servant loves it.
Your righteousness is righteous forever.
And your law is true.
Your testimonies are righteous forever.
Give me understanding that I may live.
Glory be to God on high.
Thank you.
Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord, keep your church in your perpetual mercy, and because without you we cannot but fall, preserve us from all things hurtful, and lead us to all things profitable to our salvation. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament reading is from Amos chapter 8. Hear this, you who trample on the needy and bring the poor of the land to an end, saying, when will the new moon be over, that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath, that we may offer wheat for sale, that we may make the ephah small and the shekel great, and deal deceitfully with false balances, that we may buy the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals and sell the chaff of the wheat? The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle reading is from 1 Timothy chapter 2. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time. For this I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I am telling the truth, I am not lying, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. I desire then that in every place the men should pray, lifting holy hands without anger or quarreling. Likewise also that women should adorn themselves in respectable apparel with modesty and self-control, not with braided hair and gold or pearls or costly attire, but what is proper for women who profess godliness with good works. Let a woman learn quietly with all submissiveness. I do not permit a woman to teach or to exercise authority over a man, rather she is to remain quiet. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Yet she shall be saved through childbearing, to continue in faith and love and holiness with self-control. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 16th chapter. Jesus also said to the disciples, "There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was wasting his possessions. And he called him and said to him, 'What is this that I hear about you? Turn in the account of your management, for you can no longer be manager.' And the manager said to himself, 'What shall I do, since my master is taking the management away from me? I am not strong enough to dig, and I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do, so that when I am removed from management, people may receive me into their houses.' So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he said to the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He said, 100 measures of oil. He said to him, 'Take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Then he said to another, 'And how much do you owe?' And he said, 100 measures of wheat. He said to him, 'Take your bill and write 80. The master commended the dishonest manager for his shrewdness. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings. One who is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much, and one who is dishonest in a very little is also dishonest in much. If then you have not been faithful in the unrighteous wealth, who will entrust you to the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money.' The Pharisees, who were lovers of money, heard all these things, and they ridiculed him. And he said to them, 'You are those who justify yourselves before men, but God knows your hearts, for what is exalted among men is an abomination in the sight of God.' This is the gospel of the Lord. We confess together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." You may be seated.
Thank you. Please bow your heads in prayer with me. Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God, our heavenly Father above, who gives us every good and perfect gift. Amen. Today I wanted to begin the sermon by administering a test. Now, I know it's Sunday and you're thinking, test? We're not in a school day, this isn't school, but we're going to have a test. So the test is, it's going to be an intelligence test. So the content and the purpose of this test is to see the following. What have you learned in life? What have you learned? So let's start it off. 2 plus 2 is 4. Okay, so you learned something in school. Good job. Way to go. Let's increase the difficulty a little bit. The capital of Indiana is? All right, that's pretty good, even though the answer was in the question a little bit. That's pretty good. All right, let's bump it up a little bit more even here. Ready? The best side of Evansville to live on is? A little bit of confusion there. I heard west, east, north, and I've even heard, I think, Kentucky in there somewhere, but yeah, you may not know everything in life. You may not know everything in life, but we are constantly learners in life. We're constantly learning things in life. And the story in the parable and the gospel reading for today is no exception. The manager looked at his options after being told by his master, "You're fired." The manager knew that he was too weak, he couldn't dig, and he was too proud, he wouldn't beg. So what was this manager left to do? He decided to learn from his master's dealings and use his cunning to try to make friends through earthly means. He was hoping for others to show him pity as he cut the amounts that they owed the master. But how did it work out for the manager? We don't really know. You would figure the master had to honor those agreements that he gave in honor, or else he would suffer a tarnished reputation in the business world and also in the community. So the master had to follow through what the manager did. But what we do here is probably one of the most confusing statements given by Jesus in our gospel reading for today. I think maybe throughout any word that Jesus says, this is one of the most confusing. Jesus then goes on to say, the master commended the dishonest manager for his shrewdness. So what in the world is going on here? Is Jesus actually applauding deceit? Is Jesus giving permission to do what the manager did to his master? No. And no. Jesus is not saying it's okay to be dishonest. Jesus is not saying it's all right to go look for ways to swindle one another. It's for those who work in life. Jesus is not saying that. Instead, Jesus is trying to reinforce a point that he had been teaching to his disciples since the beginning of actually Luke 15, when the tax collectors, the sinners, and yes, the Pharisees drew near. We go back and remember, though, the past several weeks we've heard these parables in our gospel readings. We know the stories. The parables of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin, the parable of the prodigal son. All of those lead up into today's reading of the dishonest manager. But what if I told you the point of the story is actually not the dishonest manager, but it's the lesson learned from the master? Look back at the other parables and you can see. The parable of the lost sheep, it's really not about that one lost sheep who had gone astray from the flock of 100 where the 99 are still okay and the lost sheep is just out there. It's not about that lost sheep, it's about the shepherd who gives up everything to go out and look for that lost sheep. The parable is really of the faithful shepherd. Look at the lost coin. Is it really about one lost coin? Or is it about the woman who lights the candle and sweeps out her house from top to bottom in order to find that lost coin. And then the woman goes and tells her neighbors, "Rejoice with me, for what was lost is now found." The parable is about the woman who would do anything to find that which was in her possession. And then we get to the prodigal son. Is it really about the prodigal son who took his inheritance before he was even supposed to get it, who went out into a foreign country and squandered on wine and women? Is that what this parable was about? Or was it about the other son who was faithful and thought that he had done everything right, but yet he was holding a little bit back for his father and his brother? No, the story is not about either son. Actually, this is the story of the loving father. It's the story of the father's love, how much he loved that son who went astray and that son who had been there always with him. It didn't matter either way. It was about the father's love for his sons. Which brings us all back to now the story, the parable at hand for today's gospel reading. The dishonest manager, or should I say, the impressed master. The master's impression of the manager had changed. He was told that he was no good, he wasn't doing his job. And now, all of a sudden, later in the story, we hear the manager was quite impressed to hear, the master was quite impressed to hear how the manager had done something. The manager had learned something from being in the presence of the master. For the cleverness of the manager is what is being acknowledged by the master. Jesus was trying to teach the Pharisees and us an important lesson, which we should have learned by now. We should have learned from the parable of that shepherd, the parable of the woman, the parable of the father's love. We should have learned it by now, but we still just haven't gotten it. Jesus was trying to teach the Pharisees and also his disciples and us probably the most important aspect: where your heart is, there is where your treasure will be found. Jesus tells this story in the presence of his disciples with the Pharisees in ears' reach, because the Pharisees' hearts were devoted to the coffers of money. They continue to be tried to be lured away and to justify their chasing after wealth instead of seeing what God gives is more value than any amount of gold or silver. We waste away that mercy that God keeps pouring out upon us day in and day out. We take advantage of it, or we just ignore it. We see this taking place in our Old Testament reading from Amos. The prophet records how the people of Israel, they were being reprimanded by the Lord there in Amos in our Old Testament reading. God had had enough with his people. Because all the people back then cared about was, when is the Sabbath going to be over so that we can bid and so that we can buy, so that we can make the ephah small and the shekel great, so that we can mess people over and buy people and trade people? When is the Sabbath going to be over? When is this sermon going to be over? The prophet Amos had to respond to them, because they had lost focus of what was important. They were more worried about the dishonest dealings and worldly desires than what they were being given by the Lord. So the Lord had enough, and the prophet was sent to declare all of what would be gone. They forgot the words of the psalmist: the Lord is gracious and merciful. He is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all. His mercy is over all that he has made. The mercy of the Lord had been ignored. The mercy of the Lord is ignored. It's at best taken for granted. So it was for the Pharisees in Jesus' day, and so it is, yes, even for us today. This mercy is being looked past. Because It comes to a point where we need to see and we need to learn about the mercy of our Heavenly Father, the mercy that He has had upon all of us. Make me to know Your ways, O Lord. Teach me Your paths. Lead me in Your truth. Teach me. You are the God of my salvation. For You I wait all the day long. Remember Your mercy, O Lord, and Your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth, nor my transgressions. According to Your steadfast love, remember me for the sake of Your goodness, O Lord. The psalmist calls us and calls unto the Lord, remember Your mercy, O Lord. Remember mercy. We are constantly being taught, we are constantly being reminded here in the Scriptures of the mercy that God has given to us through the study of Scripture, through the faith that God has instilled in us. We see how much God cares for us, His people. We see how much God cares for this creation. His mercy is new as the dew is new every day. So is the mercy of the Lord upon us. We see it at work in this congregation. We see it at work as we continue to learn and study the Scriptures in Bible class, in Sunday school, as we get together in our small groups to continue to be devoted in the Word. We see it as we continue to have confirmation, as our young people confirm that faith that was instilled in them at the time of baptism, as God has called them by the gospel. God has sent the Holy Spirit into our hearts so that we may know and that we may confess and profess with our lips and our tongues that God has had mercy. We saw it at work this morning, where a confirmation class sat here this morning from 65 years ago. The class of 1957 was here with us this morning. Those who were left gathered here, back in this very place where they were 65 years ago, as they confessed and professed the Christian faith, as they said that they would cling to that faith even unto the point of death. Well done, good and faithful servants. For you have been faithful over little, and now I will set over you much. Enter into the joy of your master. Brothers and sisters, we teach the mercy of God. We proclaim His mercy is new day by day. Jews, they demand signs, Paul writes. Greeks, they seek out wisdom. But what we preach is Christ crucified. It is a stumbling block unto the Jews. It is folly unto the Gentiles. But to those who are called by the gospel, both Jew and Greek alike, it is Christ is that power of God. Christ is that wisdom of God. It is all about Christ. It is Christ alone who saves us. It is Christ alone who gives us the power of His grace, of His mercy. It is Christ alone who reminds us who we are and what we are. We are God's children, saved by the death and resurrection of our Lord. Learned behavior. Learned behavior, it's what we're taught by example and repetition. Our learned behavior is to show mercy because mercy has been first shown unto us. God has been merciful to us, a people that don't deserve it, yet a people who get it. That is why we come into this house week in and week out. That's why we begin and we end our week here in the house of the Lord, to hear once again that word of mercy. Through the absolution of sins, your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We hear those words spoken to us and we know that God has forgiven. He has taken that sin away from us, and now we rest solely in the mercy and grace of God. We come here to this place of worship, this sanctuary. We come here to receive the gifts of God's faithfulness. As we recall our baptisms, as we join together here at this altar to receive the very body and blood of our Lord and Savior that is in, with, and under the very bread and wine. Because mercy calls out to us. For it is here, here where mercy calls out to us, to go out into the world and to show mercy so others may know the hope that is in us. Not in the hopes of getting into the good graces like that the manager did, but instead we show mercy and we know mercy to point others back to who first showed us what mercy truly is, the cross of Christ. For brothers and sisters, God knows our hearts. God knows us intimately. He knows each and every little detail about you and me and all people. He searches us out and he sees that we really need what only he can give. Mercy and love. His mercy and love. And we need it now more than ever. I want to administer another test to you this morning to show how this mercy continues to be taught and this mercy continues to be known in our midst. It's a fill-in-the-blank test. Jesus loves. Oh, now, come on, that's going to be a fail. Jesus loves me. This I know for the Bible. All right, now we're getting a passing grade here. Little ones to him, for they are, but he is. Jesus loves me, he who, heaven's gate to open. For he has washed away all my sins. Let his little children come in. Yes, Jesus loves you. And yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells us so. The Bible tells us of that great mercy of God. That God has shown us. God gives us his grace and that great gift of forgiveness in life. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now the peace that passes all human understanding, keep our hearts and minds focused in on that daily mercy that is new unto us each and every day, but that comes from God Almighty's hand. That mercy that points us back to the cross and the empty tomb, now and forever. Amen.
We sing our offering hymn as the offerings are brought forward.
Thank you.
We stand for prayer. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Kind Father, your Son declared to us that we cannot serve you and also be devoted to money. Free all your baptized children from obsession with the goods of this world, that they may set their hearts on the joys of the kingdom and the inheritance that never fades. Extend your grace and blessing upon our congregation that we might be good stewards of the treasures you have given to us for the sake of your church and the needs of our community. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, we give you thanks for our congregation and all of our members. Today we especially pray for Stacy Mitchell, Ella Moon, Jerry Moore Jr., Rose Moore, Adam, Wendy, and Daniel Morgan, and Autumn Morgan. Also grant your peace to those who are not in attendance today because of failing health, sickness, or other difficulties. And give your Holy Spirit to those who fail to worship on a regular basis, that they might be led to a greater understanding of the importance of gathering together with us around your means of grace, love, and forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus Christ, you would have your cross lifted high for all the world to see, that through the preaching and proclamation of your gospel, you might draw all people unto yourself. Continue to bless Evansville Lutheran School as our teachers, faculty, and staff faithfully share your love with all students and families entrusted to their care. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, grant comfort and strength to those who are hospitalized, recovering, sick, or undergoing tests or treatments, including Bob Grant, Frank Rankiewicz, John Woodson, Carol Stevens, Bob Hartman, Lewis Benton, Joella Sutton, Becca Anderson, Caleb Spicer, Mark Kell, Ruth Bashir, Carolyn Sparks, Clifford McMiller, Ruby Morgan, Bob Hoffman, Jeff Kachanik, Darlene Hatfield, Kim Benton, Micah Hoffman, Barbara Miller, and Luann Pierce. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, you are the resurrection and the life. Grant comfort to all who mourn, including Shannon Wright and family, after the death of her mother, Jane Hawk. Be their rock and fortress, an ever-present help in times of trouble. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, you are the creator and sustainer of marriage and family. Be with all those who are celebrating wedding anniversaries this week, including Kevin and Sarah Beach, Jeff and Becky Kachanik, Brad and Jennifer Gant, Chris and Sarah Trail, Eric and Michelle D'Souza, Brian and Carrie Claiborne, Sam and Caitlin Courtney, and Terry and Sharon Kinzel. May their love for one another grow with each passing day as they commit their care into your loving arms. Lord, in your mercy. Bountiful giver of every good gift, grant to your whole church the wisdom to use the goods of this world to be a blessing to those in need, that through the mercy ministries of your people, help and hope would be granted to all those in need, including the food pantry recipients who have requested our prayers. Lord, in your mercy. In your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.